5, 4, and we are live. Everybody, welcome back to the Liberal Gun Club's social distance learning series. We took a week off because, well, I needed to take a week off, and there you have it. So we took a week off, and now we're back. Tonight we're going to talk about ARs and how to take them apart and put them together again, which should guide you in your endeavors to purchase your first AR, if not for cleaning, possibly for assembly. And if there's enough interest, we'll put Scott's excellent How to Build an AR class online. But for now, I'm going to turn it over to the bench doctor, Mr. Scott Richardson, who's going to tell us all about the AR innards. If you have questions, if you have questions during the class, drop them into the chat. If you don't know where the chat is, it's a little speech bubble at the bottom of your Zoom screen. And then one of our moderators will pick it up and ask your question when it's appropriate. Scott, it's all yours.
All right. Well, welcome. Thanks for showing up. I'm surprised people keep coming back, but I'm happy to be here. This is an AR-15 that I built from about as much from scratch as you can. It's a 80% lower that I milled out and built and then ordered all the parts for the upper and assembled the upper and the barrel and put this whole thing together as much as you can build one from scratch. Specced out by my son from the game Far Cry 5. So I don't know why that's the inspiration. I don't know about the game, but that's what we're working with today. And we had somebody online request an explanation of the AR-15 gas system in particular. And I figured I'd go over the AR-15 gas system, how the gun works, what makes it work, and we'll take it apart. And I'll walk you through all the pieces you want to look at carefully. And when you clean one, you know what you're looking for, because part of cleaning and maintaining guns is inspecting them, and what sort of things you want to look for on the AR-15 platform. And it's pretty standard, regardless of caliber. There's little nuances with an AR-9 or a pistol caliber AR, an AR-22, but you know the guts, the bottom receiver is pretty generic. And the gas system is the gas system. It's a little bit different for an AR-22 because it's straight blowback. You don't have the receiver extension and, you know, buffer and all that stuff. But anyway, so we'll get started. I'll start with the first thing you want to do, of course, is check it. It's unloaded. You can see the chamber flag in there. I'm going to go ahead and remove that.
One quick question, Scott. We've got somebody on the chat says their AR is piston powered.
No, they're not a piston. They're just strictly gas. I'll go through that. You'll see how it works here real quick. So my chamber's empty. I've already inspected it. There's no ammo on the bench. Gun's already been disassembled. I disassembled it over the weekend and cleaned it so you didn't have to see my carbon fouled hands and watch me beat roll pins out. As much fun as that is to watch other people do, I figured I'd save you the headache.
And from a pure safety perspective, earlier, hey, Scott, can you hear me?
Yeah.
From a pure safety perspective, flip the gun up so we can see in the magwell.
Oh, yeah.
That way we can all verify. All the way up, more. Yep, no, I can see.
Now I
can
see daylight. I got a light that'll shine down in there.
I see daylight. There you go. Now we've verified the gun is safe.
Yeah, and then, like I said, it's a standing rule. I don't have live ammo on the bench if I'm working on guns. There's no need for it. No good will come of it. So I took the handguard off. This is a free-floated handguard, meaning it's only attached up here where at the barrel nut. It's not touching on a normal or a regular, old-fashioned AR. You have that front sight block that is both your gas block and your front sight. This is a newer one, so it has just a standard gas block on it, which is this piece right here. So, and this just goes over and covers that, but it doesn't touch, this handguard doesn't touch the barrel anywhere but up where it mates to the receiver. So I've already taken that off. It's just a few screws. I'm gonna set that aside. I've loosened. This is the, this will either be a flash hider or a compensator or whatever device your state allows or whatever you've chosen to put on there. There's a crush washer right here that's meant to crush. That's how you time it. It flattens as you tighten it. which allows you to orient it how you wish. On a birdcage flash hider, they have to be timed so that the bottom of it has no orifice. So if you're shooting prone, the gas doesn't escape out the bottom of the flash hider and blow dirt in your face. So that's what the purpose of the crush washer is. We'll set that aside. Now, this is what makes the gun run. Right here is the gas system. So what happens is the trigger hits the firing pin. The powder explodes. Bullet comes out. There's a little hole right here in the top of the barrel. You see that little hole right there? Gas, a little bit of gas is siphoned off and escapes through that hole. And it enters this tube right here. You can see, I don't know if you can see the orifice inside, but there's a little orifice right inside there. The gas comes down this tube into the receiver right here. And it forces your bolt back. It unlocks the bolt and forces it rearward. So that's the AR gas system. So it's strictly gas operated. There's no piston. It's just mates up. And now installing these is a little bit of a trick. You'll notice on the bottom of the barrel, there's a little index mark right here, a little indentation, and that helps you orient this when you're installing it. This little screw indexes to that, and that tells you that you're perpendicular to this gas port, so that this gas port inside the gas block is perpendicular to that gas port in the barrel. If they're misaligned, you're not going to get enough gas. The gun won't function properly. So there's a little bit of a art and science and voodoo to getting these set up properly. Some of them are adjustable, where you can adjust the amount of gas that is operating your gun. That's a separate discussion, tuning these things for your purpose. But that's what you're doing, is you're just either opening or closing the amount of gas coming through here and allowing, you're restricting the amount of gas allowed into your gun. So that's the AR-15 gas system. That's it. It runs right into here. I'm going to take the receiver, the upper receiver, off, and we can get into the business end of this thing. So to break one of these down, you just have these two takedown pins, front and rear. They slide right out. This comes right apart like that. So here's my lower receiver. You can see down in here, here's your trigger group.
Pull that, can you hear me, pull it north towards the AR-15 words so we can see down it. There you go. Perfect, thank you.
This is the hammer. When you pull the trigger, there's a little sear down here that lets go. The springs flip this forward, and that smacks the back of the bolt carriage. So let me pull this all apart, and we'll get into the guts of how this thing works. What we're looking at here. So what happens is inside the gun, these two pieces made up like that. This gas key, this is called a gas key right here. This gas comes back rearward down, forcing this bolt rearward. It unlocks it. So it will unlock this bolt and send it backward. That's what all the gas is doing, is just moving this bolt. This is called the gas key. And when you're looking at these, you want to inspect them carefully. And I don't know if it's showing up here, but this is staked. So this gas key is screwed down.
Pull it slightly up towards the camera. So yeah, I can see things you're pointing at, but if you raise it, like pull it slightly up towards the camera.
These two Allen head screws hold gas key to the bolt carrier, and they're staked. So somebody's taken a little punch and a hammer and put a little bit of an indentation in them to keep these from backing out. So when you're inspecting your bolt carrier, you want to look at this and make sure these are still staked and these haven't moved at all. Because if this comes loose, it's going to let gas escape. It's going to get dirty. It probably won't function properly. So that's all that's happening, is this gas is coming down the barrel, or, down the gas tube, forcing the bolt rearward. That's the gas system on an AR-15. It's very, very simple. Normally, when you're taking a gun apart and cleaning it and inspecting it, you're not going to pull this piece off. You're not going to take off your gas block and and go to all that much trouble. There's generally no real reason to do it unless this was occluded in some way with built up with carbon or something. And to do that, you'll see there's a little punch, a little hole right here in the, there's a roll pin right there. And that's why
we can see it on that side. We can't see it on the first side. So now we can. Yep.
That little hole has a little tiny roll pin in it. And this gas tube has a hole that corresponds with that. So you align the gas tube with that pin and put that gas pump, roll pin in there. And it's a nasty little pin to put in because it's so tiny. If you're ever going to build one of these, order three or four of these, because I guarantee you one of them will end up in low Earth orbit and you'll never see it again. So order a few of them. They're only a few pennies, and it's nice to have a spare. And you want to orient it so that the tube drops like this. It'll be intuitive when you go to put it together, the way it orients itself. So that's what's holding the gas block to the gas tube, is this little pin right there. And then this is what holds it to the barrel. That's the gas block and the gas tube. That comes down through this part of the upper receiver right there. There's a hole right there that aligns it.
No, put that back. It took a second to focus, so.
Right there. Kind of a weird, let me shine some light on that.
Shine a little light on it because I can almost see it. There you go.
Yeah, see that kind of Phillips head looking screw driver hole there? That's where the gas enters the upper receiver. And it just sort of free floats in there. There's nothing securing it inside once it's in there. So if we wanted to do a demonstration of the whole thing and how it works, I'll put this back in there. Light this on the barrel. There it goes, right there. So the gas comes down, it forces this bolt rearward like that. You can see that gas tube down in there. Can you see it?
Yep. Yeah, barely. So shine a light. I don't know, that you're going to need like three hands. You got it in your mouth, don't you?
So I got to get the flashlight in my mouth and trying to talk.
So no, put it back in your mouth and just actually.
You'll see the gas tube right there. So this, what happens is the gas forces the bolt to rotate and unlock, and it comes back in a rearward motion like that. Okay, and then the buffer does its job. It hits the buffer and compresses that spring. The spring forces it forward. It rotates back into battery and locks, and it's ready to go. Okay, so that's the AR-15 gas system. From the receiver standpoint, the lower, it's coming back. It's, if I release that trigger, that's the state it would be in right after you fired it. The bolt comes back, lays that trigger down and cocks it. It catches that little sear in there. It hits this buffer, compresses it, and sends it back forward and recycles it. And then it's ready. The next
pull. Scott, if you can move
the whole thing back in motion.
If you can move the whole receiver assembly north towards the AR-15 words.
What's that?
Move that, put it back vertical and move it north towards the AR-15 words. And then put it back vertical. There we go.
So once again, the bolt comes back. It comes back. It resets this trigger. It goes in here, hits this buffer spring, hits the buffer and compresses the spring. The spring releases all of that energy and sends that buffer forward. Goes back into battery, locks the bolt, and it's ready to go again. That's the whole life cycle of an AR-15 in a semi-automatic mode.
I'm going to turn over my moderation to Mike because apparently my audio has gone to hell. So,
okay.
I'll do that.
Now let's take a look at the buffer real quick so you can imagine. If you're not familiar with it, we'll take it all apart and show you how this stuff works. So this is your buffer and your spring. Get it all out of there. Like a slinky. So this is your buffer. Right here, it fits down in there. And when that bolt hits it, it just compresses it and sends it forward like that. the weight of this buffer has a little bit of determination on how the gun cycles, and there's weights inside here. We pop that roll pin out, this part unscrews, and there's little weights in here, and you can change the weights up or down to kind of change the dwell rate of the gun. The dwell rate is simply how much time the gun has for the bullet to leave the barrel. Okay, there has to be a bit of a delay. You cannot open that bolt while there's all that gas pressure in the barrel. So you want it to cycle, you want it to give it enough time for that pressure to be relieved, and then the bolt can go back in, or, you know, lock back in, and everything can happen. So you can control that dwell time a little bit by modifying the weights inside. You can hear it shake. There's little weights in there. But that's what an AR-15 buffer is. Now, these are different depending on which gas system and which stock you're running. This is a carbine length gas system made for a 16-inch barrel. They make what's called a mid-length gas system for like an 18-inch barrel. You can run them on a carbine as well. And then there's a rifle-length gas system, which is would be on a 20-inch or longer, like target barrel. The original AR-15s were 20 inches, and so they had a rifle-length gas system. You know, the picking the gas system and the buffer system is a little bit of a rabbit hole. There's a lot of really good information on the internet, but it's easier to understand if you've seen what it is. This is, you know, if you know what the pieces mean when you're reading, you know, the article. So that's why I wanted to do this, was explain what each of these pieces is and how they all work together. So this sits in here.
Scott, there's a question. A couple of questions, actually. The buffer spring just kind of came out. Does it lock in place, or is there a trick to getting that out?
There's a little detent. Let's see if I can show this. Right here, there's a little detent. Looks like a little nipple. Right there. So you compress that to get the spring out. Can you see it?
Yep. See it.
So to put it back in, you just kind of do the reverse. You don't really need to depress the detent to get it back together, but you do need to do it to get it out. So you just kind of feed that spring back in the tube. And this will come there. You'll see that little nipple has popped up and it's holding that buffer in place.
It just presses down. Great, thank you. Also, could you speak a little bit to the relative benefits briefly about building your own versus buying it complete? Why would you build one? What's the advantage?
Well, I think my first AR was one I just bought off the shelf, and it's great. I still have it. It runs like a champ. But I really wanted to understand them better, and so I bought a lower receiver and a lower parts kit and assembled it, and it gave me a really good understanding of the trigger and all of the lower pieces. But then, you know, at that point, you can then buy a fully built upper and made it and have a fully functioning gun, or you can buy all the pieces and put them together yourself, and then you can buy exactly what fits you. You can buy the stock you like. You can decide, I want a rifle length stock on a carbine. I have one set up that way for my son, because he was pretty young when I built it for him, and he didn't really like holding a full 20-inch AR-15. It was just a lot for him to handle. So I put a carbine upper on it, built him a special carbine upper, and it's a really fun little gun. But you can tailor this thing to exactly what you want. You can get a better trigger. The trigger will be smoother and cleaner. You can change the barrel twist rate from 1 in 7 to 1 in 9 or 1 in 12. You know, you can really tailor the pieces to whatever you like if you build one. And you'll have a very intimate understanding of the gun and how it works. And you won't have any fear of taking it apart, because there's nothing, short of cracking the lower receiver, there's nothing you can't fix on this gun. Everything you can do with just basic hand tools. Doing an upper, building your own upper, is a little bit more involved, because the most technical part of it is just mating the barrel to the receiver. This has to be torqued to specific torque settings. So you would need a torque wrench and a few tools to to do all that. I have here, this is a block that goes into the lower receiver. So I can mount that in a vise and work on it. It goes in the magwell and it makes it really easy to hold on to and get to these things. So that's handy to have. It's not a must have for building a lower by any stretch. You can do it. I've done it with a pair of roll pin punches and a pair of channel locks. The upper, on the other hand, requires an upper vise block, which is this piece here. I just tape it together so they don't, so I can lose them both at the same time. Let me move this out of my way. Set that in an unsafe place. So what this does is your receiver, oh, come on, I might have to take this sight off. Your receiver fits in here like that. And then this clamshell is over it and it holds, and then you can hold it in a vise and now you can really torque down on this nut. But you need this really secure because you cannot hold this by hand and torque that down enough. I have fairly strong hands, but that's beyond my abilities. Because this torques down between anywhere, if I remember correctly, it's like 34 pounds to 80 pounds is your range. So you got to get it to at least 35 pounds. And then you tighten it tighter to align this gas port. So it can take some fairly burly holding device to hold this in place while you do that. That's the hardest part of building an AR right there. And it's not hard, it just requires a few tools that you may or may not have. But that's kind of in a nutshell how an AR works. This is called the forward assist. It was added needlessly by the Army, of course, when the ARs first came out, because what would happen is the gun wouldn't go into battery sometimes. Let me get the bolt out. And so the bolt wouldn't be completely into the battery, into battery. So you see these notches on this bolt carrier group. There's a little wedge that pushes this forward as you push on this forward assist, which all you're doing is jamming your malfunction further into the chamber. I don't, it makes no sense to me. Most people would just rack the round out, cycle a new one. But the Army insisted on having this forward assist. You can buy uppers now that don't include this. I've never used it. It just is always on the uppers that I've bought. But it's 100% to me, not necessary. It's only a couple little parts. There's a little roll pin here that holds it all together. And it's just a wedge and a spring, and it just forces that bolt forward by those notches called the forward assist. This is a brass deflector, so as the brass comes out, it hits this and bounces off rather than flip back into the operator's face. This is just the brass deflector. Some of the very early ARs didn't have this. I guess they found that out early, the need for it. But really, to build your own upper, you're just assembling this forward assist. You're putting this little door on. This is a dust cover. So when you're not using the gun, you lock that into place and it keeps grime from getting in the gun. As soon as you cycle the bolt, it just pops open. There's a little detent right there. This spring is really not a lot of fun to put together. You have to bend it in opposite directions and thread this long pin in there. It's tedious, but you can do it with just basic hand tools. So to build one, really the only technical part is just getting that barrel nut torqued down properly and aligned properly. But that's really the guts of an AR-15. Inside the lower receiver, you just have your basic trigger. You have the hammer, and then you have a little disconnector, and then there's two pins right here that hold it all together and a couple of screws. And then you have your safety right here that flips on or off, depending if the hammer's locked, you can flip that safety. You're just assembling these things. You're just putting them together. There's not a lot of technical skill needed. You have to put your bolt catch on, your mag release on. This front takedown pin, that little detent right there is really fun. I don't know if Mike remembers how many of these did we send into the carpet.
A few
in a class. But really, you can build your own. I wouldn't hesitate to bite it off and just order the pieces and build one. I can send out a list of all the parts needed.
We may even ask you to do it on a screen.
What's that?
We might even ask you to do it on screen. I know my audio sucks. I apologize.
Oh yeah, I have a barrel on order, and I'm going to be building a retro M16A1 clone. I'd be happy to do it on screen. Just put it together, assemble the thing.
Scott, there are a couple of questions from the audience.
Yeah.
But first, an aside: if I can build one of these, then anyone can. Seriously.
Mike built a really nice one.
The questions are one about head spacing. Is it necessary to do, and why is it important? And the other one is, what kind of round count would you typically put through an AR before wanting to clean it?
As far as head spacing, I've built, I don't know, 10 of these things. I've never had one head spaced. They're all of the parts are designed to mil spec. And, you know, unless you see a defect, I wouldn't worry about the head spacing personally. I've never had one. You could buy a headspace gauge if you're concerned with it, which what it does is it goes down into the chamber like a bullet would, and then you operate the gun to make, and if there's, it's what's called a go or no-go gauge. If it go means everything is right, no-go means the head spacing is off, and then you can adjust it accordingly. Now you can order barrels from high-end manufacturers like Faxon and some of those guys, and what they'll do is they will headspace the bolt and the barrel at the factory, and then you just assemble the pieces. But it's not something that I worry terribly about with these things. Maybe I'm a little cavalier about it, but you could easily assemble it yourself and then take it into a gun store and just have them run a set of headspace gauges on it and validate that it's correct, or you can buy the headspace gauge. They're about $35, but I've honestly never seen a need to do it. As far as barrel life, cleaning, I run about 500 to 1,000 rounds through it before I clean it. They get filthy. They're dirty guns. I mean, everything gets gross. That's why I took this apart and cleaned it over the weekend, because otherwise my hands would just be coal black from the amount of crud, carbon that builds up in these things. And where you see it most is around these bolts. You know, these bolts just get filthy. This one's pretty clean. I went through it pretty well. And then you see it down in the chamber. And this is really fun to clean. This is just a real pleasure to get down in there. You can see that kind of the lugs where it all locks. Let me get this rotated properly here, where you can see the lugs down in there. That gets really dirty down in there. So it takes a little bit of time. I would highly recommend you get yourself some non-chlorinated brake cleaner and spray the heck out of it outside in a well-ventilated area, but it will loosen up a lot of that grime, and then go to it with some picks and brass brushes. But I generally go 500 to 1,000 rounds with no trouble. The gun operates just fine. My advice is always run them wet. You know, you're not going to over oil the bolt in an AR. They'll run soaking, slathered in oil. It's not going to hurt them. The lower, these don't get terribly dirty. There's not a lot of cleaning that needs to be done in there. There's not a lot of stuff that builds up. I usually just spray it with some non-chlorinated brake cleaner and then put a little bit of oil on each of the pins that the springs ride over, just to keep it lubricated, but there's not a whole lot that you need to do in these. I'm trying to think of anything else. When inspecting one of these, you want to look at these, the insides of this chamber. You can see, I'm trying to get a good view of this for you. I don't know if you can see the notches on the, where the bolt locks in.
Yeah, that's a good view right there.
Pattern look.
Yeah, we can see them.
Yeah, you want to get down in there and you want to inspect those. Make sure there's no chips or gouges. Usually when these things, the bolt, they mate to these surfaces on the bolt. And if these are chipped or broken or cracked, you're going to want to replace some parts. Nothing that can't be fixed. you know, the bolt is super easy to remove. Just pull this pin out, knock your firing pin out, and then you have this little cam that you rotate, lift out of your way, like that. That's the bolt. So, you know, if you had to, if you had a bolt that was messed up, you know, you could easily replace this piece. And then you want to inspect these gas rings on here. There's three of them. They're super simple. They're 3 or 4 cents to replace. You know, that's the kind of stuff that you want to look for, is that kind of damage. This surface of the bolt gets just crusty, and it has a lot of oil on it right now, but it builds up on here like concrete on this surface. So you're going to want some sort of a scraping tool to remove that. And they make a lot of specialized tools. I had one on the bench here just a few minutes ago, made specifically for that purpose. Well, I can't see it, but anyway.
I've got a bone tool here, Scott.
What's that?
I've got a bone 3-in-1 tool.
Yeah. I found it, if you don't let them get too crusty, that these work great. You know, you can remove a lot of it. Now, if it, you know, you run it a long time, it'll build up and you'll feel it with your fingernail. It'll build ridges. And so you want to clean that stuff off. There are tools made to do it, but inspect all this, you know, inspect your extractor and you know, take a look and make sure that there's no damage to this thing. This is just a straight up bolt carrier. These things don't generally fail. Like I said, if they do, it's because this gas key's come unstaked, or it wasn't staked from the factory. So when you buy a bolt carrier, make sure it's been staked. If it hasn't, tighten it down and stake it yourself. It's not hard to do. You just take a chisel and all you're doing is bending over a little bit of the metal to keep that screw from backing out.
Hey, Scott, we have a couple of questions. One about the virtues of a drop-in trigger versus other types. And also, do you recommend a sonic cleaner for the bolt carrier group?
Sure. Heck yeah. If you're not cheap like me, yeah, a sonic cleaner would work great. Just a 50-50 mix of simple green and hot water will clean a lot of this crud out of there. And then as far as a drop-in trigger, the only aftermarket triggers I've ever put in are the Geissele triggers, and they're not a drop-in. A drop-in trigger is basically the Geissele's that I use. You pop these two pins out, you pull all the trigger guts out, and put them back in, and they all go in the same way as a regular mil-spec trigger. A drop-in trigger, you pop the two pins out, and the trigger is almost like a cartridge that drops into place, and all of that stuff, you don't need to reassemble all the little pieces like the disconnector and the little disconnector spring and the hammer and the hammer spring. And, you know, you don't need to fiddle with aligning all that stuff. They just drop straight in. I've not used them. I'm sure they're super simple. But if I can put a mil-spec trigger in an AR, then a drop-in trigger is got to be super simple to do. I just fell in love with the Geissele triggers myself. They're fantastic and they're pretty reasonable, but you can also, someday I should do a video on how to stone a trigger to smooth it out, but you can also get into a lot of trouble doing that. But you can take stones and you can stone a few of the different parts of the triggers made up and smooth them out a lot. You're not removing a lot of material, you're just smoothing it out. And this one I've stoned. I've taken this trigger out and taken some really fine Arkansas polishing stones and polished the surfaces. The warning there is you do not want to change the geometry of any of those mating surfaces in the least bit, because then things can go horribly wrong. You could find yourself in federal prison, you know, if you got one to run away from you. So you want to be careful stoning a trigger, but it's not rocket science. You just have to be very, very detailed in how you do it. So, you know, when cleaning these things, I usually just, like I said, I spray some non-chlorinated brake cleaner in here, get some patches, dry everything out, compressed air, either from a compressor or a can of like dust off, and just blow all the crud out of there. And it's also a good thing I just put a couple of drops of oil on each of these pins, and then you can take your compressed air and just lightly blow that oil around, and it will cover that whole pin. That's all I do on the lower. Every once in a while, I might pull the buffer spring out and clean it with a rag, and then put a little bit of grease or oil on the spring to keep it from rusting or corroding, but there really isn't much to do on the AR lower to maintain them. For the upper, it's just getting all the carbon out of, you know, the chamber, and in the body of the upper receiver. And most of your attention is going to be spent on the bolt, disassembling it and cleaning it, putting it back together. But yeah, as somebody mentioned, ultrasonic cleaner works great for doing that. Put these back together is pretty straightforward. Go line that. Got my pin back in. Put my firing pin back in. Drop that down. This. I think I showed this in the very first one, how to do this. Okay, so the pin's back in, and then you just take your cotter key, right back through there. Aligned. Hold on just a second. Pin back in there. As you notice, I never use a steel-faced hammer on this stuff. I always use a brass or nylon hammer so I don't mar things up. Can't see down in there. I'm doing everything in front of me. Anyway, that pin drops back in there and that reassembles the bolt. So that's really the stuff to look for on an AR. The other thing, of course, is always when you're buying a gun, check the crown of the barrel right here. It's not easy to do on an AR. And it can be re-crowned because what happens is usually there's some sort of a muzzle device on there and you can't see down in there to check the muzzle. But, just when if you're cleaning one and you have the muzzle device off, carbon will build up on this surface and around here. So take it off every now and then and clean it off and clean that crown, because that does affect the accuracy. A little burr or a little crud on there can affect things more than you would think. Any more questions about this, or should I put it all back together?
I think we're good to reassemble.
All right, let's do it. You get the cotter pin back in there. There we go. So now this bolt has been reassembled. All I had to do is get that pin back in there. So when putting this back together, I'm gonna go ahead and let's see. Take my charging handle. The charging handle just drops down into a little slot into the receiver. And hold on just one second. This is always hard to do on camera because you are doing it from an angle that you normally wouldn't. So you want your bolt extended out like that, not in, out. Drop it down in there. All right, so that's all back together. I don't need to close that up, but I will. And then you just meet these two pieces up. You're just aligning this front takedown pin with this hole here. Can't see what I'm doing.
While you're reassembling, I think we have somebody is opining on the benefits of the Faxon barrel. Is that what you?
Oh, they're fantastic barrels. Yeah, if you're building an AR for accuracy. Get a Faxon barrel and order the bolt and have it headspace to that barrel, and you know it will be probably the most accurate AR you'll own. I have a friend that runs one he shoots his out to 600 yards, and I think it's a 22-inch bowl barrel made by Faxon, but he's really happy with it. Now I'm going to do this gas block. This is going to be a little bit of a tedious thing to watch. Grab. So what I have to do is I have to make sure that this little screw indexes into that hole, that indexing detent on the barrel there. And you want to make sure that it's aligned straight. And I can't describe it, it's just done by feel. So I'm sorry for that. There we go. Let me tighten this down. This one down. This one yet. That one. Back.
Okay. I have a question, Scott.
Be a grill on these. Just snug them down tight.
That's is, there a, is there any torque requirement for those little screws there at the gas block?
I'm sure there is, but I don't pay any attention. I just tighten them down snug. I usually, something like this, I would put a drop of blue Loctite on there. If you use, I never use red Loctite on guns. I just don't, because it's just such a pain if you have to remove something. But I'll probably take this apart at some point. This gun is going to be modified a million times as my son gets older and changes his requirements. But what happens is, you know, this gets really, really hot and the metal expands and contracts, and they're difficult to get off after they've been run for a while anyway, but a little drop of blue Loctite wouldn't hurt you there. I'm going to go ahead and drive that roll pin punch down just a tiny bit, because it's raised here. So if you've never seen roll pin punches, this is what they look like. I don't know if it's showing up on camera, but there is a little raised dimple right there, or like a nipple on the end of that punch. And that fits down into the orifice on the roll pin, and it helps you guide that pin in. And on these, what I do when I'm putting these together is I take the original roll pin and I hold it with a pair of needle nose pliers, and I just chamfer the leading edge of the pin all the way around, just a tiny bit, and then feed it down in there and tap it in. And it helps, it just narrows it a tiny bit and allows it to go in easier. It's just a trick I've learned. You can hold the pin with a pair of needle nose pliers and just tap it down to get it started. And then you can take your punch and drive it through. But this little pin can be a real bear sometimes to get in there without sending off into space. Let me go ahead and just tap that pin down a little bit. Just want to get it flush so it... This is not the best angle to be doing this. Normally I would have a block. I have a roll pin block that this would sit on. As I drove that pin down, if it goes through, it drives right through the block and it won't go lost, but I don't have it in front of me. So I'm gonna do this. That's it. So that's flush on that side, flush there. So that's good to go. Now I can assemble my.
And we seem to have lost your video. It's frozen.
This just locks into place like that. And there's a couple of screws right here.
Hey, Scott, I don't know if you can hear me. Yeah, your video on your phone is dead.
Oh, good. All right, well, hold on just one second. I'm blaming Ed for that.
Well, I've had audio problems.
How about now?
No, still dead. Does anybody think my audio is any better, just for record?
It's a little bit better, yeah.
Nobody likes you, Mike. Your phone. I think your phone might have just left the chat. So everybody, partner.
Well, it's only a brand new $1,000 phone. Well, all right. Let me switch video systems here. It'll take me just 1 second. We're almost done anyway. All right.
While we're doing this, a show of hands. Who thinks I sound like a robot? Put it in chat. Because I think it's Mike. Mike's audio sucks, and it's not me. But you know, I'm willing to take the. Oh shit! Well, no, you're not supposed to do that. It's a bit distorted. All right.
Can you switch over to my other camera?
I can try. This camera right here with your face in it.
Yeah, shit. We're on you now, Scott.
No, you not. See me?
Yeah, I can see you.
Okay, can you see the gun at all?
Nope, we're looking at your powder thrower.
My what?
Your powder dispenser.
Oh, all right.
Yeah, there we go. That's better.
So all I'm going to do is tighten these two Allen keys, just clamp this down, and then this stakes it up a little bit into the barrel. So that's all I'm doing is tightening these.
If you could push your camera down a little bit, it's right at the bottom of the screen as it is. That's good. Thank you.
There. All right. I think I've got it on the right video.
I'll do this one after because that doesn't feel right. I want to put some Loctite on this one. For our purposes, it doesn't need to be here right now. Anyway, so it's all back together.
Is that the first gun you put back together successfully on screen?
I got the Colt Single Action Army back together.
Mostly.
I mean, they all involve a hammer. All right, but that's it. I mean, that's really the AR-15 in a nutshell. You know, kind of. I wanted to really go more over on the functionality of it, because somebody had asked specifically, you know, how the AR-15 gas system worked, and so that was sort of the genesis of the whole thing. But then, you know, that took 5 minutes. So I figured we'd go into a little more detail about what an AR-15 is and how it works. And now, you know, if you wanted to take the time to build one yourself, I encourage you to do it. There's a lot of great resources for parts, and there's a whole lot of tutorials out there on how to do it. And I would be happy to, when my barrel comes in, maybe in a couple of weeks, I will just sit here and build that gun for you. You know, we'll assemble the lower and then put the upper together. I may not have the furniture yet, but that's really simple stuff to do. The furniture is the easiest part of it. It's getting the guts into the lower receiver and getting the barrel onto the upper receiver, torqued down, lubricated and torqued down properly. And I'll show you the sequence in how you do it. You made up the barrel nut, you tighten it down, you put a little, I use this aero grease, this stuff. And you grease the threads, you tighten it down, loosen it back off, tighten it down. You do that 3 times and to stretch and condition the threads on the receiver. And then you torque it down to the proper torque spec. And then you time that gas system a little, you know, you want to then at that point, orient the gas system properly. And that's it. That's really all there is to putting these things together.
Well, that's good stuff. I mean, actually, hold on. So apparently I sound like I'm in an echo chamber. We're going to blame Paul for that. It's his audio gear that he sent me. Does anybody have any other questions before we let Scott go have a beer?
There might be some interest in a milling an 80% receiver at some point.
Oh, that sounds like it's going to get us banned on YouTube.
That might not be it. We might have to do that outside of the YouTube realm, but I would, if you want to sit here and watch me mill out a lower, I'd be happy. What I would do is show you the steps. I wouldn't have you stand here for 2 hours listening to my router sending aluminum chips into every corner of my garage, but I would explain what I'm doing. And then it would probably be better to do to just film the whole thing and then edit it.
That might be a more
tutorials sort of on YouTube, or there used to be on how to do it.
Although it would be really interesting to just sort of set a camera up and let it run, and then somebody can watch the whole damn thing happen.
Yeah,
I'm the kind of idiot that would do that. It's like I need to watch the whole thing.
Yeah, so. It's.
How about other questions other than the hypothetical? Let's watch something that we didn't do today. Yeah, you got a bunch of people. Got a bunch of people
grease up a Garand, right?
Yeah, we want to do the Garand next time.
Right. So
hopefully my audio is clear enough and not too tinny to say next time we're going to do a Garand. He's going to take it. He's going to take it apart, show you the op rod, show you all the cool stuff because we are a CMP club.
and the CMP.
Oh, somebody mentioned the Mark II.
No. Screw that.
Take that apart and show you the game of Tetris that is putting one back together.
I think in honor of the CMP reopening this week for sales.
We got to do the Garand. That's a must because we are a CMP club and we own that much. Not to mention, it's the best resource out there. If you want to own a Garand, it's worth it to jump through the minor hoops to get one through the CMP. You'll get a much better rifle that way for a lot less money.
All right, so I'm sort of staring at the questions, and all I'm seeing are rude things from Lonnie. So I think we're going to go ahead and call this.
All right.
At 54 minutes past the hour. Thank you, everybody, for showing up. We will stay past. We'll unmute everybody. You guys can ask whatever questions you want. Be as rude as you want. Like Lonnie. Otherwise, we'll see you in the pub. Thanks so much for coming. And Scott, thanks again. It was an awesome class.
Thank you, Scott.